Hey folks, my name is Dan Meyer from Desmos.
And I'm Bethany Lockhart Johnson.
We're very excited to bring to you folks a ongoing video series called Math Teacher Lounge, and we want to acknowledge right off the jump that people have very different have had very different experiences with teacher lounges in the past. I'm just curious, Bethany, where have you been at with teacher lounges in your past experience as an educator?
Well, when this title came about, I automatically had positive feelings because a chance for us to chat and have a conversation about ideas in education and themes and topics that we care about. So I actually didn't at first associate it with a teacher lounge, but I think it's important to acknowledge that the teacher lounge in school spaces is not always a space where conversations are safe, where conversations are welcome, and it can sometimes become this like venting zone that you often hear some pretty problematic language about the way people talk about their students, the way they talk about each other. And I remember when I was a student teacher, I remember my mentor teacher telling me that we were going to eat lunch in the classroom. We didn't go to the teacher lounge because it was just like a gripe zone. And so it wasn't until I was actually in the classroom that I've experienced both. I've experienced teacher lounges where it didn't leave me feeling recharged. It left me feeling like, oh, I actually just feel kind of crummy. And then I've experienced other teacher lounges where there are people brought emotion, brought exhaustion, brought funny stories, and you kind of just decompressed.
Yeah, I hope that we in this video series live up to the highest potential, the highest ideals of a teacher lounge as you have described it. And I was blessed in the two schools I taught in to have very, very positive teacher lounge experiences where, yeah, people brought their problems and brought their challenges and suffering. But it was never phrased as though that was like inherently the problem of the students or their homes or their cultures, or even that they were unsolvable problems. The problems always had solutions. We just hadn't found them yet. And I'm super thrilled to have a colleague like Bethany in my teacher lounge right now. As one of our segments that we'll do periodically here, we're going to try to figure out something together. We're going to try to make each other smarter by bringing our different lenses on the world. Bethany from the K-5 world, me from secondary. And one of the things that we're trying to figure out right now is distance teaching. How is it going for people? We've each brought here a number of artifacts. We'll share them with each other and then talk through it briefly, helping each other make sense of them. So Bethany, you're up first.
I am an educator, primarily kindergarten, lower grades, and I remember the first day of Zoom with my kindergarten students. And so I really had a deep, deep appreciation for this picture that I'm going to show you. This is from educator Chrissy Noel, and I love it. It's distance learning day 4. So I just want to show it to you, Dan, and
yes,
see what pops up for you.
This is my colleague at Desmos, Chrissy Newell now, newly out of the district office there in Stanislaus County. And I recognize some of this from my own experiences with my kids who have not been to a playground, my toddlers, since March, and just the need to do something with your body beyond sit still is really calling out to me from this particular clip here.
Something that I loved about this tweet, she got some pushback of people commenting about the teacher or commenting about, you know, it. She really spoke back to it and said, hey, this isn't a critique of the teacher. This isn't a critique of the lesson. This is the reality of you're a little kid in front of a computer. And so she was actually celebrating that he needed to move. And I feel like doing this as well sometimes when I'm on a Zoom meeting, although I'm quite less graceful than her son is. But to parents and caregivers out there, this is a really weird, wacky situation. And if your child is not sitting still in front of a Chromebook or device for stretches of time, like, it's okay. It's okay.
This right here on the left-hand side is an email from a college professor to students. And you can read the whole thing, but you kind of get the all caps, bold text vibe real fast off of it. And at the very end there, it's like, I would hate to have to write you up for online cheating. And on the right-hand side, just to give some context here, was a Zoom session with teacher and students, and the teacher mentioned that they had a cat, and a student said in the Zoom chat, quite simply, two words, no punctuation, show cat. And I wanted to know what you thought about what you're seeing here.
So I have read this on the left about this testing protocol, and I was really thinking about students who needed accommodations, students who did need to look away, look in the distance. This policing of students' bodies was really disturbing to me. And the first thing that stuck out, this no head covering. Yeah, it takes away, first of all, certain students' religious rights, and then also students' just self-expression and comfort. I may not want to have my head exposed for a variety of reasons. You're seeing more and more these kind of protocols put into place that are policing, particularly Black and brown bodies, that in the school space, and you know, demanding that cameras are on for students across the board, and demanding that students show their space. This is really worrisome.
Before, it was just kind of like in classes, your body was policed. Now it's like your home environment is policed, it feels like. And maybe the artifact on the right doesn't have as much to do as I thought with that, but it's just something about show cat.
When we're on Zoom, we're guests in each other's home. Like, I feel like you and I right now are inviting people into our space. To be in a student's space and to see their, you know, I was in students' kitchens and in their rooms. They were really excited to show me things on their wall in their room.
There is an opportunity here, it feels like, for teachers to be, you know, open with their own lives or to create connections with students that wouldn't be possible in a classroom scenario. Like, I'm not bringing my cat to class to teach, but I reference my cat and can show my cat, and that in itself can create a moment of connection with students that maybe was impossible before or less possible. I just want to like offer a couple tweets that are in similar veins for us to sort out here. And yeah, right here, a couple folks expressing, I don't know, thoughts that feel similar and different at the same time.
Yeah. For some teachers, I know that they have said that this is really working. They're getting to try things that they haven't tried before. They're getting to do small groups in a way that they weren't able to do before when they had 30 kids that they were navigating. But then being able to pull a small group into a breakout room was really positive. And like Marianne is saying, and Dingle Teach is just this, it's also okay that we're not okay, that this level of exhaustion and things that are being asked of educators and of students is, you know, yes, there are some people having this great experience, but we also want to honor the reality that, you know, teachers and staff aren't okay. And I really appreciate the vulnerability and the honesty.
Yeah, teachers are asked to do so much and do it with a smile. And that needs to be said again and again. So thank you so much, Bethany, for making me smarter about distance teaching, helping me see it from your vantage point. This is like the ideal teacher lounge conversation. Yes. For me when I was an educator. Appreciate that. Folks, I'm so happy to have with us right now someone who can help us figure out what is going on with virtual teaching, with distance learning right now. Idil, would you introduce yourself and let us know what you're up to currently?
My name is Idil Abdulkadir. I am a math coach with the Ottawa-Carleton District School Board. I am brand new to this role. I was in the classroom in the spring. We had most of our semester online. So I teach math. I am a self-taught and kind of novice computer science person, but don't ask me too much about it. And like Dan said, I spent the first 6 years of my career teaching newcomers as well as the mainstream math classes. So students with limited prior schooling. So that meant in our city, at least, that those students were refugees. And so that has informed a lot of my practice in the class around making safe classrooms, making classrooms that are accessible for English language learners, and kind of thinking in a more interdisciplinary way. So that's me.
Fantastic. We, Bethany and I wanted to figure out, wrap our heads around what is going on with how teachers are constructing rules and norms in this new environment for learning. We have a much stronger handle, I think, on what to do with a face-to-face. And so what we did, and would love to have you participate in, is we went to Teachers Pay Teachers, and we downloaded the top five sets of rules, which, as you might imagine, is designed very very cutesy, like very cute clip art of students and some nifty fonts. And just to get a sense of like, what are the really popular kinds of rules that are out there? And so what we've done here is is we've set up rules, and some of them are from this set of teachers pay teachers rules, and some of them are fake, made up by us. And we just love, first of all, to share with you each of those rules and just see, based on your experience with students and teachers, which ones strike you as like, yeah, real. That seems like what I've been seeing a lot of, if not in your board, but just like in general, and which ones seem fake. And we'll then just invite you to think a little bit with us about what effect do those rules have on the safety of students in learning communities. You ready to play the game here?
I'm ready. Born ready. Let's go.
So here is rule number one, turn your camera on. Is this real or fake?
Real. It's real.
Okay. Yep. Okay. No emojis in the chat. Real or fake?
I hate this, but it's real.
Answer is fake.
Thank God.
No background images.
This is fake. But it's real. I bet it's real. Feels real.
Ooh, answer is real. All right, no pets. How about it?
Oh, no. No, that's got to be fake. That for me, that's too far.
Here we go. Answer is real.
Oh, no.
Strong. Wear your mask at all times.
No, that's fake. That is fake.
No one was fooled by us here, Bethany. All right, here we go. No toys.
Oh, I bet that's real. That makes me very sad.
Answer is real. And the very last one is... no hanging upside down from your desk.
That is fake, but the image is real.
Image is real. This is from our colleague Chrissy Newell at Desmos, who was just recently reached out to by The Ellen Show regarding her ultra-viral tweet. You had a strong reaction to one or more of those. Pick one and let us know like how you think that inhibits the creation of a safe community of learners from your experience.
For me, I think for no toys, I'll empathize with the teachers who, you know, it's distracting to have a kid playing with something on screen or, you know, obviously not paying attention, or it might be distracting. But thinking about students who, one, need to fidget, I've been playing with this pencil the entire time. And so I think for students who need to fidget, that's all kinds of kids. Especially now when you're at home sitting in front of your computer for so many hours, that's more kids. It's probably all kids considering. And then for students too, who coming from a trauma-informed lens, like sometimes people need a grounding object. They need something if they're anxious, if it's math class, or if they're doing something they don't want to do, or if they're having a bad day. They have, I don't know, here's a thing I love. It's a forget-me-not, and it's crocheted. From my friends at my old school, so I wouldn't forget them. And also a plant that won't die, so I won't kill it. But I might want to, if I'm feeling stressed out, hold this in my lap. And so for students who have experienced trauma or students who are experiencing difficult situations or emotionally dysregulated, grounding objects might be toys. Things that make them feel safe might be a physical object that for you looks like a crocheted forget-me-not, or a stuffed animal, or a blanket, or something you might not understand as a therapeutic or grounding tool that helps them learn better. So no toys, bad news, people. Toys.
That's super helpful. Yeah, it's worth remembering that these rules often turn teachers into cops in students' home lives, which just feels like a really sad role change for teachers, and an even sadder kind of environment for students as well, as bad as it is in class. In a classroom to feel that way. Thank you so much. Yeah, please, Bethany.
I know that after this conversation, folks may want to follow more of your work. If you want to share how folks can connect with you on Twitter or whatever you'd like to share, we'd love to make sure we spotlight that as well.
Twitter. Oh, Twitter. It is. That's where I'm at. I'm at Twitter with my first name, IDIL_A_. And so Idil_A_. I live on Twitter far too much time.
Thank you again. We'll see you there.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us for our first episode of Math Teacher Lounge. Before we go, we want to hear from you. So we are curious, what is your most essential Zoom expectation? We've talked about some really, really troubling ones, and some ones that maybe should stick around. But if you had to pick an essential Zoom expectation, what would you pick? You can email us mathteacherlounge@gmail.com, or you can send us a tweet @MTLshow.
Many thanks also to our guests and our sponsors, Amplify and Desmos. And we're going to end this thing the way all good conversations in the Math Teacher Lounge end, which is too short and interrupted by a bell, which then sends us grabbing our coffee and running off to class.
See you next time.